Thank you so much. I cannot tell you the sense of gratitude that I feel. I have been on a tour that hasn't stopped since the book came out, and I am so humbled by this. I worked on this book for 15 years. This is a book. This is my version of it. So it has a lot of wear and tear. And I go everywhere with this particular version of it. But if this were a human being, 15 years, it would be in high school and dating. That is how long I spent on this. So it means so much to me to be able to talk to people who appreciate the book, appreciate what the time that went into this, but most importantly, appreciate what the people of this great migration did for all of us, for all Americans, and how this migration began, why it began, and why in some ways they left a legacy for us that we are still living with and still trying to understand. I began this book because in some ways this is the story of my own family, but of course it's the story of the majority of African Americans that you might meet in the North and West, and it's a story of the majority of African Americans in the South because we've all been touched by this. And because this story, the title of the book is The Warmth of Other Suns, and the subtitle is The Epic Story of America's Great Migration. That's the putative title of the book, but the book is truly about so much more than that. It is about the marriage of South and North. It is about the unwitting ambassadors of Southern culture who carried the South with them with their King James Bibles and their 12-string guitars, and carried the South the recipes that they had to carry in their head as they went north and transported Southern culture with them. Everything that these people did was in some ways a reflection on the South, because ultimately they were Southerners. And when they raised their children, they raised them as Southerners too. I've been described, my mother came from Georgia. Sometimes we just say Rome and people say, wow, Rome? And then I add the Georgia and then. And my father came from Southern Virginia, Petersburg, Virginia. And they eventually met in Washington, D.C., where they both migrated. And had there been no great migration, had there been no great move toward these other sons, I might not even exist. And the same could be said for many, many African Americans in the North and the West. But this is essentially, in some ways, a classically American story, a universal story, a human story, because how many Americans on the whole can trace their lineage to people who came from a great-grandmother from Ireland, who met a great-grandfather from Italy, who might never have met had there not been someone who had the courage and the foresight and the vision and the dreams to decide to jump off a cliff, basically, cross the Atlantic, and end up in this country, meet someone that they never would have met otherwise, and start whole new lineages in this country. That is essentially what happened with this great migration, and I wanted to be able to tell the story because I, too, owe my very existence to that. These people, ultimately, then, that I've written about are in some ways proxies for people in all of our families, all of our families. That's how we got here. Now, this great migration, give you a little bit of background on what it is. It was, in essence, the mass defection from a caste system which, to this day, is almost unimaginable, really. When I described to you the things that people had to endure, not just black Southerners, but all Southerners, because the caste system is something that is an artificial hierarchy. It's a structure that holds everyone fast in an assigned place by virtue of their birth. It is not even a choice. It puts tremendous pressure on every interaction between people based upon what they were born into, which was often determined by how they looked. So that an example of that is that in Birmingham, Alabama, for example, it was against the law for a black person and a white person to merely play checkers together. Someone in Birmingham must have seen a black person and a white person playing checkers together in some town square and decided that they were just having too good of a time, and that the entire foundation of Southern civilization was in peril and this could not be. We couldn't have it. And if you think about it, if you translate that into some other arbitrary factor of a human being's appearance, it's as if you were to say a person with blue eyes could not play checkers with someone with brown eyes. And that is how arbitrary that is. And that meant that everyone was constricted. Of course, not far from here in Raleigh, there was, and also in Atlanta and other parts of the South, there was a black Bible and a white Bible to swear to tell the truth on in courtrooms throughout the South. And I became aware of this because of a story that ran in a Raleigh newspaper back in the 1940s. And what had happened was there was a trial in progress, and a person of color had taken the stand. And the judge, upon recognizing this, said that that's the wrong Bible you're giving him. He has to have the colored Bible. And that meant that the sheriff and the bailiff and all of them had to go and hunt down the black Bible so this person could swear to tell the truth on, which meant that people of different castes, all God's children, but people of different castes could not touch the same sacred text. I've been asked, was it a different Bible? What, did one have the King James Version and another had American Standard? But no, they were the same version of the Bible. It's just that they could not touch the same book, the actual text. They couldn't touch it. And so that was the world that they were living under. And of course, this meant a great deal of, it was a nerve-wracking, nervous-making experience to have to anticipate and to remember all of the arcane rules and protocols, which could for some people mean their very lives. There was a case in Mississippi in which a man, an African-American, asked for a receipt for the water bill that he had just paid. And that was not considered acceptable in that particular county, and he was beaten up for it. He actually survived the attack, but he was beaten for that, which is just, you know, it almost doesn't sound like the United States of America. It sounds like another planet. And in many respects it was, but also shows you how far we've come. Now, I've been all over talking about the Great Migration and what it meant and how it has meaning for us now and how there are many descendants who live with us today, in the world today. There are people in the South who have relatives in the North and people coming back. We're very much living with the after effect of this Great Migration. And as I try to make it real for young people, I chose to pull out one example. Now, there are no references in the book to restrooms or water fountains, and that's because we know about that already. There was no need to talk about that. In fact, I wanted to show the things that would not be so obvious, the kinds of things that they had to deal with, consider, and give thought to every day, every waking moment that they were living under this caste system. So the example that seems to get to the young people has to do with the question I'm about to ask you. How many of you in the last, let's say, week have passed someone on the road? Almost every hand has gone up. You might have passed someone on the road just to get here, just within the last 15 minutes, right? And when I ask that, people are almost afraid, like, is it okay to have passed someone? Is she about to ask us if that's okay? No, it's perfectly legal now. Believe it or not, for African-American motorists, it was against protocol and against the law for them to pass a white motorist, no matter how slow that person was going, no matter that that person might have been a Sunday driver, no matter that that person was maybe lost and kept stopping every 10 feet because they thought this was a turn. Nope, it's the next turn. And that's what they had to do. That is an example of the dailiness and the fact that they had to live under an artificial set of rules that would almost have been so impossible to keep up with that what it meant was that people just shrank from one another. And all kinds of amazing and beautiful relationships that could have happened otherwise never had a chance to come to fruition because the people had been artificially separated in ways that go far beyond just separate schools, but separate spaces on your person, such that it turned out that the majority of whites and blacks during much of the time of this caste system, and I'll give you the dates just shortly, had never shaken hands with someone of another race. That's how extreme this was, because there was just this general separation. Now, this Great Migration began during World War I. It began because of a problem that the North had. The North had a problem because World War I had begun, and that was considered the European War. And during the European War, immigration from Europe essentially came to a halt. And the North had a problem because it had all these foundries and factories, steel mills and railroads that needed to have workers, and they began casting about for the best place to find the cheapest labor that they could. And that led them to the South, where many African Americans, most were underpaid from the beginning, no matter what they were doing, whether they were teachers or whatever other position. But others were not being paid at all. They were working merely for the right to live on the land that they were farming. They were sharecroppers. And so the North came looking for labor. When the North came looking for labor, the people answered the call. They'd never really had an option before that moment. When this great migration began at the beginning of the 20th century, 90% of all African Americans were living in the South, 90%. And what that meant was that there was a vast oversupply of cheap labor, too many people, not enough work, and the workers needed to be there, according to the Southern economy, for such things as planting time and chopping time and harvesting time, whether it was for cotton or for tobacco, rice or for sugarcane. And so there needed to be this oversupply of workers. But that oversupply of workers meant the value of the work was depressed, and even the value of their lives were depressed. And so all of this was what was feeding a caste system which was in place to maintain the economy as it had been. When the South came calling, and when the North came calling, the South responded in many different ways. There were some who were thinking that this could be a good thing because maybe it would relieve the South of the burden of this oversupply. But the majority of people began to see that, what are we going to do about the plantations? What are we going to do about the farms? How are we going to get the cotton out of the field? How are we going to make sure that our gardens are taken care of? How will we make sure that our children are taken care of? So they began to wonder and began to figure out what must they do. And what they did was they tried in every way possible to keep the people from leaving. They arrested people from the railroad platforms when there were large numbers of African Americans holding northbound tickets. They would actually board the train and arrest people from their seats. And when there were too many people to arrest, they would wave the train on through so that all of those people who had managed to save up for months or maybe longer than that, holding these northbound tickets, had to watch the train to what they perceived as freedom pass them by and figure out what are they going to do next. So that wasn't all that the South did. The South then made it very inconvenient for people in the North to come and poach their labor. They actually created laws that required any Northerner to pay $25,000 to recruit one black person. Now, this was in World War I. The equivalent of that would be $500,000 now. $500,000 to recruit one black person. What company is going to pay that? So that was quite discouraging to the idea of any Northerner who wanted to do that. And yet it didn't stop the people from leaving. In fact, it all in some ways fed the desire to leave because it was a reminder of just how constrained their lives were. And it actually had the opposite effect. And so the people made plans to leave, but it wasn't always easy to do so. And I'm going to give you a couple of examples of how difficult it was. Clearly, someone like Dr. Foster, Dr. Robert Joseph Pershing Foster, he had been a surgeon in the U.S. Army during the 1950s, and he had performed ably for the U.S. Army. But it turned out that when he got out of the Army, he couldn't practice surgery in his own hometown of Monroe, Louisiana. And so he set out on a perilous journey, unexpectedly so, from Monroe, Louisiana to California, which is where he planned to go to be able to practice surgery and also to raise his young family. But when he got outside of what he thought were the bounds of Jim Crow, it turned out that these people that I'm talking about, these Southerners, were running into a headwind of resistance and hostility that they hadn't anticipated, which is one of the reasons why I felt such a sense of empathy for the people. they have been in some ways miscast on so many levels. There have been assumptions about the people who participated in this great migration, that they didn't really leave in order to work, that they actually wanted to go to the north just to get on public assistance, or that when they got there, they just brought nothing but crime, that when they got there, they actually didn't work. And the exact opposite is true, and I want to make sure that I mention this here, because we are here in one of the great cities, one of the great states that contributed to this great migration. Whatever is said about people in this great migration, these people who went north, they're saying about people in the South, because these people were Southerners. They were Southerners at heart, and they might have left the South, but the South never left them. The idea that they went not to work is anathema. It's a complete opposite of what they were all about, because these people had known nothing but work. That's all that they had done. They had worked from sun up to sundown, can see to can't see, as they would put it. And they had known nothing but work. By the time they got up to these northern and western cities, all that they knew, they had every reason to do whatever it took to survive. And let me give you a couple reasons why. I think you can really appreciate this. For them, and for anybody who migrates from a long way away, jumping off a cliff into the unknown and hoping that life might be better with no guarantees whatsoever of success, there is no option but to do the best that they can. Failure is not an option. They can't fail. And you know why they can't fail? First of all, they're a long way from home and they don't have the same support structure. But the main thing is they could not have the people back home saying, see, I told you so. I told you you weren't going to make it. I told you not to go in the first place. That is exactly what they wanted to make sure they never heard. So what they would end up doing is, and many of the people who stayed, can certainly recall the arrival of the people from the north. These are people who were Southerners who were coming back to put on a show for people here. And they put on a show. One thing that they would do is that they would make sure that they had the finest clothes that they could possibly get on credit or whatever it took in order to show the people in the South that they were doing just fine. They made sure that they had the biggest cars that they could borrow from whomever they knew. And they made sure, I even was told in the course of working on this book, that of interviewing these 1,200 people, heard so many stories, that they had a special going home wad of money. And this was money in which it was a thick wad of bills. On the inside were lots and lots of ones. And on the outside were the 20s and the 50s. And the hundreds if they were doing, especially if they really wanted to make an impact. And the people back home were just ooh and ah over how well the people were doing. Now, they did not say that they weren't sure how they were going to make the rent the next month, but at least they had put on a show for the people here at home. My own mother tells a story, and it's very interesting about my own mother, because people, if you read the book, you'll see some references to my own family. And I want to, I like to remind people that every reference to my own family in this book came as a result of hard work and everything that I could do to get my mother to talk, because she was the toughest interview of all. In fact, if she became aware that something was slipping out, she just shut down right then and there. So every reference in the book actually comes not from my experience of growing up with her and my father talking about their experiences. The people of this great migration often didn't talk about it. They were from a silent generation overall, and they certainly didn't talk about the heartbreak and the sadnesses and the homesickness that they had to endure. So those were some of the things that actually every reference in the book to my own family came as a result of things that I learned after beginning to work on the book. I did not know any of this before working on the book. But she did let slip that one of the things that she did when she would come back to Georgia, that she didn't come back that often, but when she was able to come back, because it had to be a show, of course. I mean, she wasn't going to come back unless she could have everything in place. And she just got in a new Pontiac, and just about half an hour before driving in to Rome, Georgia, she made sure to stop at a car wash to make sure that that car was clean. Shiny and clean. She could not have the people seeing her in a dirty Pontiac because it was new, and she wanted to make sure that she made a good show for the people on Gibbons Street in Rome, Georgia. So this is the kind of thing that they went through in order to, it meant a great deal to them to be able to show that they had made it. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about the the scaffolding, the structure of this migration, and how beautifully predictable all human beings are and how all migrations are. There were three migration streams. One was the one we're right in the middle of. It was the East Coast stream. It was the one that carried people from Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, and Virginia to Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, to Boston, New York, and Newark, often by accident, because the people there, it happens to be that that they had been riding for a very long time, and they knew they were listening for New York, Pennsylvania station. But Newark also has a Pennsylvania station. And it sounded close enough for them, and a lot of people got off, and that's one reason why Newark has a population that it does. Now, that was the one stream. Another stream was the one that went up the midsection of the United States, which took people from Mississippi, Tennessee, Arkansas, Alabama, to Chicago, Detroit, Cleveland, and the entire Midwest. And then there was the third stream, which took people from Texas and Louisiana out to California and the entire West Coast. And in some ways, all of this is beautifully predictable. This wasn't just a haphazard unfurling of lost souls just landing wherever they happened to. This was a very orderly and predictable relocation of people based upon the railroad lines and the bus routes, so that when you go to Washington, D.C., where I grew up, almost everybody's mother, father, grandmother was from North Carolina, South Carolina, Virginia. That's just the way that it was. It was so predictable that you almost took it for granted. And that's one reason why this story hadn't been told, because it was so very obvious people might have thought it wasn't even worth writing about. But I can assure you, it was. In some ways, it was predictable in the same way that if you go to Minnesota, you find that there are a lot of people from Scandinavia there. And that's the same idea. People clustered together in colonies and followed one another. And one of the things that they did is that they recreated the old country in the new world. And they carried with them everything that they could to remind themselves and to recreate what they had back home. Many of them had not really wanted to go, and if they'd had a choice, there's a quote from a man who went to Pittsburgh, and he said, if I had had any other choice, if I'd had a choice, I'd rather have stayed home, he said. I would rather have stayed home. But under the circumstances, they didn't. And one of the goals of the book is to have each of us, anyone who picks up the book and decides to go on the journeys with these people, the goal would be to have people to ask themselves, think deeply into their own hearts and say, what would I have done? What would I have done if I'd been in the same situation as the people here? What might my own ancestors had to have gone through in order for me to be where I am right now? Those are the essential questions that I wanted to be able to explore. Now, I want to share with you a couple of interesting things that happened to me along the way of doing the reporting. Now, anyone who's lived in the South long enough realizes that each state is quite different. Texas is very different from Alabama. Mississippi is different from Georgia. Georgia is different from North Carolina. Florida is different from all of them. And so all of these states are quite different. And when they transferred when they moved to these different states in the North, in other words, I view this as the greatest transfer of Southern culture, truly, that the country is known as well. These people became unwitting ambassadors of Southern culture where they went, planted themselves there. I would guarantee you that it may be easier and quicker to find pig ears in Chicago than right here in North Carolina. Really, that's just how ubiquitous it was. But one of the things that happened for me is that I found myself going from place to place looking for people who were part of this great migration in the North. That meant that I had to go to senior centers, AARP meetings. I had to go to, I went to Catholic churches in California, in Los Angeles, where everyone was from Louisiana. I went to Baptist churches in New York, where everybody was from South Carolina. Everybody. There's even a South Carolina and a North Carolina ball in Washington, D.C. to this day. That shows you how very long the arm of Southern culture happens to be. One of the things that I ran into was that when I was in each of these different places, I found that I had to win over the people. I had to find a way to get in the good graces of people who otherwise I would not have been able to do. Excuse me. And I ended up finding that when I went to these different places, I was exposed to food that I was not accustomed to. Went to Los Angeles and found that they ate oxtails. Yeah. Anyone heard of oxtails? I had never had oxtails. And there are not that many hands that went up, if you notice. Well, no, look. Oh. No, look, if this were Louisiana, every hand would go up. And so what happened is that I had to find ways to become accepted to the people because I did not have the same, because I was from a different stream, I'm from this stream. So I'm in the middle of my stream. And when I go into another stream, that means that there are different touch points, different cultural reference points, different cities and towns that people, different names. Everything was different, more different than you might expect. And that's because each of the originating states is quite different. And so in Los Angeles, I keep saying Louisiana because it is Louisiana West, ultimately, I found that I had to find different references. When I went to Chicago, I had a little bit of a crisis because I happened to be on a bus that was had been chartered by some seniors who were part of this great migration, and they were going to a floating casino in Iowa. They had met in the parking lot of a Jewel food store at 87th and Stony Island. Does anybody know what that, anybody?
Yes.
Oh, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And so they had gotten there. It was very early in the morning, packed bus. And when everyone got on the bus and got situated, someone broke out a package. It was in ice, and it was direct from the source. And when people became aware that it was on the bus, there was an uproar on the bus. People in the back wanted to make sure that they saved some for them. What the person had done is that they had shipped to them from their aunt in Mississippi hoghead cheese. Hoghead cheese. And when the people found out that there was hoghead cheese, everyone got excited on the bus and wanted to make sure there was enough. But the people there, were very gracious to me because I was kind of a guest, and they offered me some first. Now, how many of you know what it is? Oh, okay. Well, I have to say, in my migration stream, in my experience growing up in Washington, D.C., surrounded by people from North Carolina and South Carolina and Georgia, and my Georgia mother and grandmother had not ever made hoghead cheese. I had never heard of it. I had no idea what it was. They pulled it out, and I saw what it was. It was gelatinous. I knew it had something to do with the hog and a head. And none of that really sounded appealing, I'm sorry. And so I demurred, and I said something about blood pressure, which I did not have. And they seemed to accept that as a worthy excuse. And they did not insist that I'd partake, which I did not. But you see that that was a challenge in the process of all of that. I risked exposure as not being of that stream, but I had to be true to myself. But let me tell you this, when I got to New York looking for seniors at a senior center in Harlem, there I met a woman who knew my father from Petersburg, Virginia. Now that is the power of the predictability, the beautiful predictability of human behavior when it comes to the migration stream. I had had to win over the people in the other parts of the stream, but when I got to the terminus of my migration stream, I was home in my own way. And that's the reason why people who are here can feel very much at home in Washington, D.C., feel very much at home in Philadelphia, feel very much at home in New York, because in some ways it is home. And that's one of the beauties of it. Now, there's so much that I could say, and I want to leave time for questions. But I can never talk about this great migration without talking about the effect that this had and the moment of departure and what this really meant for the people, if you think about it. And I've written about three people. One is Ida Mae Brandon Gladney, who is a sharecropper's wife who was terrible at picking cotton. Just horrible. I mean, you don't think about people being good or bad at it. You just did it. Well, actually, there, wherever two or three human beings will be gathered, I guess their hierarchy will develop. And there are those who could brag that they were really good at, could pick 400, 500, 800. I mean, by the time they finish talking, it's that much. And she would admit... She would admit that she could never get 100 to save her life, just could never get 100. But her family ended up leaving under very difficult circumstances, under great pressure, duress, having to do with violence that occurred to one of the family members, and they headed to Milwaukee and ultimately landed in Chicago in 1937. The second person was part of this migration stream. It was a man named George Swanson Starling. He had a little bit of college, but the money had run out, and then he ended up returning to Central Florida, where he returned to the work of the people around him that was picking citrus fruit. He could see that the people were being taken advantage of. He was good with numbers and had gone to college, which the other people hadn't. And he began to agitate for better wages and work conditions for the people. But that was a dangerous thing to do in the 1940s if you were a black man taking on the grove owners of that era. And so he ended up having to flee for his life, and he headed to Harlem in 1945. And then finally there was Dr. Foster, who went from Monroe, Louisiana, to California. And so those were the three main people. But one of the things that I want to make sure that I just so hope people will take from this is to remember to think back to the people in all of our backgrounds. If you were among the people who stayed, if you were part of another group of people who came from across the Atlantic or from across the Rio Grande or from across the Pacific and have ancestors who did this, to think about that moment of departure, to think about the fact that the people had to look into the eyes of their loved one and of their mother or their father, their sister or their brother, the grandmother who raised them, whoever it might have been, and to not know if they would ever see this person alive again. Never know if they'd be able to look into their eyes and be able to give them an embrace. Not know if they'd ever be able to sit down for grits and bacon, that's getting into my migrations. That's what I grew up with. It was grits and bacon together. And so the idea of that moment of departure where they didn't know what the future held, to think about the fact that, remember, there was no Skype. There was no email. There were no cell phones. There was no guarantee. Even long distance telephone service was not necessarily something that you could depend upon. And so, how did you want me to do? I'm gonna switch out. Okay. Is this gonna work? Okay. Now you can hear me. So there was no guarantee of anything, and yet they had to know, and the parents had to look into the eyes of this loved one, this young person in that family, and to pray over them and to hope that all would be well, not knowing if they would live to see them again. This was one of the great, had to have been one of the greatest moments of heartache for any family, and it was necessary for us to get to where we are as a nation. The effect of this great migration, we are still trying to even come to understand. There are so many ways to measure the effect of this great migration. One of them is the great gift that it was to culture in general. So much of what we accept and view as American culture is actually the culture that grew out of the marriage of the North and South, the transporting of Southern culture to the North, interpreted and expanded upon, developed, and created by these Southerners and primarily their children, and then a gift to the world. The American ear, when it comes to music, and which means thus the human ear, because American music has been imported over the world, so that American music is in some ways world music, is changed dramatically because of the Great Migration. musical forms that might not even have existed exist because of this great migration. Jazz, for one of them. Jazz would perhaps not even exist as we know it had there been no great migration. And North Carolina was one of the great participants and contributors to this. Thelonious Monk migrated from North Carolina as a five-year-old with his parents, went to Harlem, where he had the opportunity to be able to take music lessons, and his parents were able to do a little bit better for themselves so they could afford whatever it took to help him to develop his genius. It would have been so much more difficult to do that in the tobacco country of rural North Carolina where he came from. When it comes to Miles Davis, his parents migrated from Arkansas to Illinois, where he had the opportunity to develop his genius. His parents had been fairly well off, but still that was considered a luxury in the cotton country of Arkansas. And John Coltrane left North Carolina at the age of 17. And he went to Philadelphia, where his mother was already, and his mother, upon his arrival, gave him an alto sax, a used alto sax. Where would jazz be if John Coltrane had not gotten hold of an alto sax? Where would music be? And not just American music, but music for the world, because these people are as revered in Paris and in Tokyo as they are here in the United States. These are gifts to the world. Motown would simply not have existed at all, because Berry Gordy, his parents migrated from Georgia to Detroit. Once he got to be a grown man, he wanted to go into the music industry. But he didn't sing, and he did not play an instrument. But he wanted to go into management of music. He wanted to create a record company. But he didn't have the money to go scouting all over the country to find the best talent. So what did he do? He looked around him. And all around him were these second generation Southerners, basically, teenagers who were singing in some ways their own interpretation of what they were hearing at home, the gospel music, the spirituals that they were hearing at home, the blues that they were hearing at home, interpreting it in their own way in this new place. And he saw a couple of people got his attention. There was a girl and her two friends, 14, 15-year-old girls. And I want to remind you that actually these two, the main one, the one who didn't have the best voice but apparently had all the personality, she would not even have existed, and you know who I'm talking about. She would not even have existed because her mother came from Alabama, father from West Virginia, met in Detroit. We wouldn't even know her name had there been no great migration, because she wouldn't have existed. Of course, we're talking about Diana Ross. And her two friends, Mary Wilson and Florence Ballard, also were children of people who come up from the South. And they were children interpreting what they had heard, were hearing at home, and they wanted to go into music, and they were ready for when he chose them. Now, Berry Gordy also heard about this very large family in Gary, Indiana, very large family. There were five boys in the family who apparently were making a splash in the little talent shows in these tiny little garages and auditoriums throughout the industrial city of Gary. He heard about them. Apparently the youngest one was the one who could sing and dance the best. The youngest one was the front man for the group at all of the age of 6 or 7. And he auditioned them. And again, these are people we would not even know their names, because the mother came from Alabama, father from Arkansas, met outside of Chicago, married, settled in Gary, Indiana, and now, as a result of that, the Jackson Five and Michael Jackson, we wouldn't even know their names had there been no great migration. That's an example of the impact of all of that in terms of culture. Other aspects of culture, Toni Morrison. Her parents migrated from Alabama to Ohio, where she had the chance to do something that she couldn't do in Alabama. And that is, as a child, young woman wanting to go who was good at writing, good with language, to go into a library and take out a library book. That was not allowed in Alabama at the time she was growing up. Had her parents not done that, she would not have gotten the exposure to literature in the way that she would in Ohio. It's unfortunate, it's sad, it's tragic that she wouldn't have been able to do that. But her parents, because as a result of their decision, the sacrifice that they had to make of leaving all that they knew for a place that they'd never seen in hopes that life would be better, made a way for her to be able to be a Nobel laureate. I mean, you kind of need to be able to read a book if you're going to become a novelist and become a Nobel laureate. And so that's what she had the chance to do. August Wilson, every single one of his plays, I challenge you to see all of his plays, every single one of them was an attempt to deconstruct and understand the Great Migration, every single one of them. He himself was a child of the Great Migration who, too, wouldn't have existed because his mother had come from North Carolina. North Carolina was a great font of creativity and genius, wouldn't you say? North Carolina can stand proud when you think about the gift to the world, ultimately. But yet, this is another one, and his mother and his grandmother went to Pittsburgh, where she met a man who was already in Pittsburgh. He was an immigrant, actually, and you have yet a whole other wave of talent and creativity and genius explored through theater. The same goes for Lorraine Hansberry in A Raisin in the Sun, Raisin in the Sun out of Chicago. When it comes to all of these things, this is a great gift to the world. But this is what I want to really leave you with. The effect on the country when it comes to politics and economics and the, in some ways, incorporation of North and South into a whole, which is ultimately was one of the great legacies of this great migration. And it occurred in this way. The South, at the beginning of this migration, had an oversupply of labor, which was cheapening both the value of their work and of the lives of the people who were in this lowest caste. The people, this is a leaderless revolution. No one sounded the day or the hour that the people should go. No one actually said that this would be the wise thing to do. Something in the hearts of these people said, it will be better for us if we spread out in this land. And so some of the people made the hard decision to do that. And in doing so, they ended up having an impact north and south. The impact on the South was that it helped to show both South and North, to tell you the truth, that the lowest caste members in this country, thus in the South, had options and were ready to take them. That was a first in American history. That had not happened in these numbers. We're talking 6 million people who left the South from World War I until the 1970s, when this caste system finally was unraveled after the civil rights era. And so these people showed North and South that they had options and they were ready to take them. Secondly, by being in the North, they provided in some ways a safety valve for the people who stayed and had to bear up under the sheriff's hoses and the dogs that would ultimately be used in the final conflict that would lead ultimately to freedom, not just for African Americans, not just for African Americans, but for the South as a whole. It was freeing the South of the great burden of a caste system that was holding it back on so many levels, economically, culturally, and spiritually, a way that we often don't think of it. Because if you are expending so much energy holding other people down, that means that you're not doing other things that could be lifting yourself and others up. So it's a tremendous waste of energy that went into over almost 100 years of Jim Crow and the caste system that was holding everyone in its grip. And so this freed everybody. It made the South a more welcoming place for people who were Northerners, who would have otherwise have met many people in the course of working on this book who said, I would never have moved to the South had it not been different. It's a more open and welcoming place for all people. There are immigrants coming from other parts of the world who might not have felt as comfortable coming. But all of this put pressure on the South to ultimately change and opened up things for everyone. And then finally, the people who were in the North who ultimately made this tough decision. They made the decision not just for themselves, really, because they had already experienced the hardship that came from being in the caste system, the dual education system, the inferior education, the lack of nutrition, the lack of access to health care. All of those things they'd already endured. But it might be better for the children. The children might do better. And so let me give you an example of what this meant. Southerners can be proud of this, and that is that those people who went to the North met incredible resistance, incredible challenges, incredible assumptions and stereotypes about the way that they talked, the way that they looked, what they were wearing, the fact that they might have been considered lazy because they walked a little bit more slowly, they talked a little bit more slowly until they got into the rhythm of Southern, the fast pace of the city. And so they bore up under a tremendous amount. They were considered the outcasts upon arrival. And yet it was these people, these Southerners, who ended up being among the when it came to these cities and their first black mayors, the first black mayors of every single major American city in the North and West. Again, the first black mayors of every major American city in the North and West were the children of the South. Not the people who've been in the North all those years, but the children of the South. And let me give you examples. Tom Bradley, Los Angeles, the son of sharecroppers from Texas. Unbelievable. Carl Stokes, he was the son of people who had migrated from Georgia to Ohio. Coleman Young, he was the son of people who had migrated from Alabama, and that he became the mayor of Detroit. Harold Washington was also a son of people who had come from Kentucky, from the South. I started looking at all these cities, and then I just said, well, let me look at this one, and I kept running into more. And so then I came to San Francisco. Willie Brown, he had been he became the mayor of San Francisco. He himself had been a cotton picker in Texas. That's astounding. When you think about the people who had been the lowest caste members upon arrival in these big, forbidding, competitive cities, becoming in less than a generation the head of these cities, no matter how well, and they ran into a lot of resistance and problems even there, but the fact is that they made it, and that was far beyond what their humble beginnings would have said. And even New York, David Dinkins ended up, he was the son of a barber from Newport News, Virginia. That is astounding, every single city. And that's something that I think Southerners can take pride in, because these were people who ultimately were Southerners. But this is the thing I want to leave you with. This migration was a leaderless revolution, which means that there was no one who was telling them what to do. In fact, a lot of them don't even consider themselves part of any great movement, and yet they made all of these changes in this country. They ultimately did what the Emancipation Proclamation couldn't do. They did what both houses of Congress could not do. They did what the President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, could not do. They did what the powers that be in North and South could not do. They freed themselves and, as a result, helped free both the South and the North, but more importantly, the South, of the grip of a caste system that was holding everyone back. And the title of the book, of course, is The Warmth of Other Suns. It comes from something that Richard Wright said, and I'm going to read that to you. It's very, very short. It reads, I was leaving the South to fling myself into the unknown. I was taking a part of the South to transplant in alien soil, to see if it could grow differently, if it could drink of new and cool rains, bend in strange winds, respond to the warmth of other suns, and perhaps to bloom. These are the words of someone who was about to embark on a journey with no guarantees. He was about to make a huge transition in his life. He was about to make this decision that where he had no idea what he was going to be facing when he got there. And yet he made this decision anyway. And the lesson for all of us, I believe, is that means if they could do all that they did with absolutely nothing but just a wish and a prayer and a dream and a hope and something inside of them, a conviction that it had to be better wherever they were going, then that means that we have it within us to do that as well. We have it within us to be able to make the decisions that we have, the tough decisions. And ultimately, after having spent so much time on this, I've concluded that there are no other suns, actually. There really are no other suns, because the people who did the best in this great migration and in any immigration experience are those who realize this, that the sun is within us, that whatever light was coming had to come from within, and that any success that they might have had to have come because it was within them anyway. And it was a matter of them planting themselves wherever they happened to be and being able to make the most of that where they were. So there are no other suns. We are the sun. And I so appreciate your listening and to see so many people out. Thank you. Oh, thank you so much.